Karl Marx said that the alternative before the human race is socialism or barbarism. The events which we saw in Paris last Friday were an example of barbarism at its worst. And this barbarism, this act of sheer, wanton, cruel savagery took place not on the streets of Beirut or Baghdad or Damascus, but in a residential area of Paris associated with pleasure of people on a Friday night taking a quiet drink in the cafes, going to a restaurant, or going to a rock concert. And with these scenes of unbelievable slaughter and savagery, in effect, the Middle East has come to Europe. Before the Second World War, Leon Trotsky made the following prediction. He said that at the end of the Second World War, the United States would emerge as the dominant world power, as Great Britain had been in the past. But he added a very significant phrase. He said, yes, the Americans will be the dominant world power, but they will have dynamite built into their foundations. Now, the truth of that prediction was borne out very graphically, in a very explosive way, with the destruction of the Twin Towers a few years ago, just over a decade ago, on 9/11. Now, if you like, in France, in the streets of Paris, the French people have suffered their 9/11. And what it means is that all the terrible crying contradictions of capitalism on a world scale have now come back to haunt the peoples of France and to haunt the peoples of Europe. After these events, there is a general sense, a profound sense of fear, of anxiety, of insecurity, that these atrocities, these atrocious occurrences could happen anywhere, at any time, affecting ordinary people. Oh yes, it's always the ordinary people, isn't it? The ordinary workers, the young kids, who are not responsible for the crimes of imperialism, who were never consulted about bombing Baghdad or Raqqa or anywhere else. Nevertheless, they pay the price. As they paid the price, the ordinary people, of course, the masses, have paid the terrible price for the crimes of imperialism. Which flow, of course, we mustn't forget that it flows fundamentally, all of these things, they try to deny it now, but it's a lie. They all ultimately flow from the criminal invasion of Iraq by American imperialism, backed, of course, by the lesser European imperialist powers. These actions have turned the entire Middle East into an absolute chaos of war, of endless war, of terrorism, of murder, of mayhem, of suffering on a colossal scale, which of course is summed up in the terrible tragedy of the refugees, who also now, I note, there's an attempt made to make them the victims of this atrocity in Paris. Now, you see, what's the basis for this? The impression is created in the media. First of all, Hollande, the president of France, said that this was an act of war. Of who against whom? Well, evidently, it was supposed to be an act of war, a declaration of war, he said, of ISIS, of these fundamentalist lunatics, against France. The impression is created, you know, of a kind of colossal, huge, monstrous enemy which is present everywhere, which is lurking in the shadows of every town and city of Europe, ready to plant bombs and to kill people and so on. It's almost an invulnerable colossal, powerful enemy of the state. Now, in reality, of course, it's no such thing. There's a kind of paranoia now has been created. Always the same with these terrorist incidents. Paranoia is being created. The other day they cancelled a football match in Germany, I noticed, saying there was a concrete evidence of a bomb. I didn't see anything subsequently about any concrete evidence at all. It's part of a general panic, a general fear and a paranoia against an apparently powerful enemy. Now, in reality, I would maintain precisely the opposite. This action of ISIS, I think it was ISIS that was behind this, far from being an expression of power, is an admission of extreme weakness. The fact of the matter is, from a military point of view, ever since the Russian intervention, because in effect the West was pussyfooting, they were the so-called bombing of the Americans and the so-called coalition, evidently had no effect or very little effect on ISIS. Everything changed with the Russian intervention. The Russians certainly mean business. Of course, first of all, supporting Assad, who they will maintain, irrespective of whether the West wants that or not. The Russian intervention is, as you could expect, is a thoroughgoing bombing campaign, which overnight, as I've expressed on previous interviews, has transformed the whole situation. It's put ISIS on the defensive. It's also put the West in an awkward position. The Americans, who were pussyfooting around, were split in effect. That's the reason they didn't know what to do. Now, suddenly, they've been forced into action. There's been a revitalization of their campaign, using other people, of course, not the Americans themselves, although the Americans are involved in this on the ground. It was admitted the other day in somewhat of a shamefaced fashion. It wasn't Obama that admitted that, but some minor White House official. That's because they don't have legally they don't have the right to do this. No, it was the Kurds, the Peshmerga and the other Kurdish forces, PKK forces, that have been on the offensive. They've reconquered ground in Iraq, so that the ISIS is in retreat, in effect, in Iraq. I note that this morning on the news, a spokesman of the Kurds actually said, they said, look, ISIS could be finished militarily in a matter of months or even weeks. It would be sufficient for the West to make up its mind to do this. I think that's been the case all along. If it's not been done, the reason is that the West has got its own interests, mainly to topple the government of Bashar Assad, and therefore they, in effect, have been slyly supporting, if not ISIS, then other equally monstrous terrorist, Islamic fundamentalist terrorist groups, reactionary groups, inside Iraq. Of course, the Russians don't care about that. They've bombed hell out of all of them. And therefore, this has forced the West to come to an agreement with Putin. So I predicted that they would do that, and they've done it. It's clear. And they've had to swallow all the nonsense. They've had to swallow and accept, in effect, Putin's conditions. First of which, of course, is the maintenance of Bashar Assad. And therefore, there's been a stepping up, an intensification of the campaign against ISIS. And this is their response, to resort to attacking so-called soft targets. That's to say, slaughtering innocent people, civilians, in Paris, which doesn't actually, in my opinion, require a lot of effort on their part. It's true that it would require a certain degree of planning, of finance. They got plenty of money, mainly from the Saudis, by the way. The Saudis, the Qataris and other gangsters, the Turks also, have been backing them systematically, although this is hushed up. The role of Saudi Arabia and Turkey has been hushed up in the West. They've got plenty of money, plenty of resources to do this. Of course, in the irrational paranoia which has been stepped up since this terrible incident, people look around for a scapegoat. Yes, and they found a very convenient scapegoat in the form of these thousands and thousands of poor, suffering, hungry, cold, bedraggled, half-dead refugees which are fleeing from the conflict in Syria. It's quite monstrous how the right wing in particular has seized upon this, particularly Le Pen in France, who's made a big issue of this, but others also. have tried to victimise, to criminalise these poor, unfortunate refugees, arguing, in my opinion, falsely, that, look, ISIS is using the refugees to smuggle people into Europe. You know, I don't think ISIS has got any need to smuggle anybody into Europe. They've got plenty of supporters in Europe that to do their dirty work for them. You know, plenty of cells are organised. Or even more dangerous from the standpoint of the state, unorganised individuals like the one that murdered the British soldier, Rigby, on the streets of South London a while back. No, ISIS does not require to go to all the trouble of smuggling people in through the refugees, risking getting drowned and all the rest of it. On the contrary, the fact of the matter is this. Because they're losing the war, because the situation on the ground has become more and more unfavourable and difficult for ISIS, it's very difficult for them now to get people to come from Europe, as they were doing, in large numbers up until recently, to come and fight on the ground in Syria. And therefore, they've decided quite intelligently from their warped point of view, to say to these people, say to their supporters in France, in Belgium and so on, no, no, you stay where you are and carry out terrorist attacks on enemy territory, that's to say in Western Europe, which is what they are evidently doing. So the argument about smuggling people in with the refugees, it doesn't hold any water for any sensible purpose. The question arises, of course, where do they get these recruits? How on earth do they get young people so fanatical that they're prepared to blow themselves up and slaughter innocent people, innocent kids, in a rock concert and in a cafe and so on and so forth? Now, the answer to this question cannot be found in Syria. It must be found in France, in Belgium, in Britain and many other countries. Why is it that a layer of the youth of North African extraction or of Arab extraction or of African extraction are prepared, can be recruited in this way? Many of them, by the way, are recruited in the prisons. I note many of these young people are of a very low, poor socially, not all of them. There's a mixture here involving also petty bourgeois elements. In that sense, it's reminiscent of fascism, although I think we must be careful about drawing superficial analogies. But the social composition of this gang is a lumpen proletariat on the one hand, the most depressed, lower stratum of society, which Marx referred to as the passively rotting scum. That's a little bit unkind, but there's an element of truth. The criminal elements, petty criminals that have end up in the prisons. The prisons therefore become recruiting grounds for the extremists, for the Islamic fundamentalists, mixed up then with an element of petty bourgeois elements, crazed petty bourgeois, I would say, of students, intellectuals and other riffraff that have fallen for this poisonous jihadi ideology. It's an explosive mixture. Yes, but the solution for that is in society itself. These banlieues, as they call them in France, these poor suburbs, these terrible, deprived slum areas where the youth unemployment is, what, 40-50%, perhaps more, and where a whole generation of young kids are condemned to a life of nothingness. They are annulled, they're alienated, they're completely alienated from society, therefore resort to crime in order to exist, to drugs, and other things. Incidentally, it's also a criticism, a profound criticism, a condemnation of the labour movement, of the labour leaders in these countries that should provide these kids with a revolutionary ideology to change society, fight against oppression and alienation, or fight against unemployment, which of course means the socialist revolution. That's the real answer. The fact that the labour movement have failed, miserably failed, I would say. The fact that everywhere the labour leaders, the trade unionists, pay no attention to the unemployed youth, do not attempt to organise them, do not, above all, provide them with a revolutionary perspective of changing society, that drives them into other avenues of supposed protest, which is not a protest at all. You know, the argument that they're fighting against the state, they're fighting against imperialism, is complete nonsense. On the contrary, every time there's a terrorist atrocity of this sort, it doesn't harm the state in any way. It doesn't dent the bourgeoisie. On the contrary, it helps the state. You know, you have to understand that. Our criticism of terrorism, all terrorism, by the way, is not a moral question, that they kill people, that we're against violence and so on and so forth. That's not a Marxist position. But the fact that it is counterproductive, it does not work. Its effects are counterproductive. It helps the bourgeois state to consolidate it, as you saw after 9/11. Did that dent American imperialism? Not in the slightest degree. It played into the hands of the most ferocious reaction. You had the homeland laws, other laws restricting democracy and so on. Now they're talking about strengthening, in Britain, for example, Cameron, despite all his talk about reducing the deficit and cutting public spending, just voted a large amount of, I don't know how much, a billion and a half, I can't remember, almost 2,000 new agents for the intelligence services and other repressive measures which they're going to adopt. So in that sense, the terrorism plays into the hands of reaction, and in this particular case, the jihadis want that, as a matter of fact. They desire it. It's monstrous, as a matter of fact. They desire the victory of Le Pen in France. They desire the victory of reaction. They desire that they want the state to react so that then they think they can recruit further layers of alienated youth who will be affected by the general repression, because this repression doesn't hit the terrorist very much. To some extent it does, not very much. But it hits the broader population, particularly in France, the North Africa and the refugees, and people like that would be affected by this. And therefore a section of them will be driven into the arms of the terrorists, which is just what they want. It's monstrous, as a matter of fact. This is what we mean, this is what Trotsky meant when he said that dynamite is built into the foundations of all the imperialist states, not just America, but France, Britain, Germany, Belgium, all of them are affected by it. But the general world crisis, the general world madness, if you like. I noticed that the other day that the Vatican put out a statement condemning the act. Of course, we all condemn this murderous act of terrorist barbarism, but adding that it was madness. Well, I suppose you could say that it is mad. These people are a bit unhinged, as a matter of fact. But in the words of Shakespeare in Hamlet, though this be madness, yet there's method in it. There's a logic behind this. And the reason is that the crimes of imperialism abroad, in the Middle East in particular, now come back to haunt all of us. And it's a menace to all of us. I recall what Tony Blair said, that terrible gangster, that liar, that corrupt bastard, when he dragged the British people into a war which they did not want, on entirely false and lying and mendacious basis. He argued that this would save the British people from terrorism. Let's be clear about this. Before the invasion of Iraq, and I don't intend to defend Saddam Hussein in any way, he was a dictator, he was a monster, that's all quite true. Whether the Iraqi people are any better now than what they were under Saddam Hussein, I very much doubt it. Very much doubt it. This was an act of imperialist aggression without any basis whatsoever. The argument about weapons of mass destruction was shown to be a complete lie. British people were deceived. But not only that, this barefaced liar, Tony Blair, argued, if you please, that there wouldn't be any more terror. We'd be protecting the security of the British people. On the contrary, by their actions, they've created this monster of jihadi terrorism. The main people that suffer, after all, is the people of the Middle East, by the way. They suffer atrocities like the Paris atrocities almost every day. It doesn't even make the headlines anymore. Nobody cares about these people. That's one point that must be made. But in addition to that, is it true that by intervening and bombing and attacking and so on, that these politicians have saved us from terrorism? On the contrary, by their criminal actions, they've increased the risk of terrorism 1,000% and made all of us into targets for these monsters, these jihadi madmen. What's the solution? Well, the only solution to this terrible situation, the only solution to the threat of barbarism is what Karl Marx argued over 150 years ago. The alternative is socialism or barbarism. The elements of barbarism clearly exist now on a world scale, and this barbarism is increasingly affecting the so-called civilized nations of Europe and other areas. Yes, Karl Marx was right. The only solution, the only alternative to this barbarism of capitalism, of capitalist decay, is to fight for the socialist revolution. That's the only way. To provide the youth, including the mass of Islamic Muslim youth, dispossessed youth, give them a real alternative which is not neither more nor less than the fight against capitalism, against imperialism, for the socialist revolution and the victory of socialism in France, in Britain, in Europe, and on a world scale.